Especially the development of amblyopia and the complications of corticosteroid therapy. Approach to pediatric uveitis is similar to adult uveitis. First, we'll take the detailed history. Then, child undergoes complete ocular examination. We do the naming, then systemic evaluation, followed by meshing. Then we order relevant laboratory investigations. Then we make the start the child on treatment. And if they are refractory to treatment, we investigate further. And also, we tackle the complications secondary to the uveitis or this management. Coming to the neonatal and infantile uveitis, they can be examined and documented in a similar way. The visual acuity can be assessed by the Taylor acuity cards. Handel's slit lamp examinations can be used to examine the anterior segment and indirect ophthalmoscopy to assess the posterior segment inflammation. Older kids, first we have to spend some time to develop the confidence, and we need to explain to them what we are going to do, what we expect them to cooperate. Then they cooperate for all examinations. Sometimes I can tell you they are better than the adults. And slit lamp examinations and indirect ophthalmoscopy can be done like adults. Imaging in pediatric uveitis, as already told by Dr. Anand, so I will not go into the details. Move on to the neonatal uveitis. What we see commonly is endophthalmitis. Most of the kids have septicemia and they have a prolonged NICU admissions, following which they develop infractions. Here is a child who had an abscess in the right hand, following which we could see the whitish exudates in the anterior segment. An AC tap revealed the gram-negative bacilli. The child received intravitreal vancomycin and ceftazidime. Subsequently, after stabilization of the systemic conditions, the child underwent lencectomy with vitrectomy along with topical and systemic medications, but resulted in a thysical eye. Here, a 47-year-old male infant present during ROP screening, they detected the vitreous ace and the lesions in the posterior pole of the right eye. On investigations, toxoplasmatitis were positive. The CT scan of the brain was normal. The child was treated with antitoxoplasmic treatment for 1 year and systemic steroids for 6 weeks, following which there was complete resolution of the inflammations in the patient with a good improvement in the visual acuity. Whenever we see a congenital toxoplasmosis, immaterial whether the lesion is active or inactive, we need to treat the child for antitoxo treatment for about 1 year. Here is a classical case where you have a retinitis and also the classical punched out lesions has mild hydrocephalus. Subsequent treatment with antitoxone systemic steroids, that is resolution of the lesions in both eyes, and also the hydrocephalus is resolved. This is the OCT picture showing the presence of posterior vitreous cells, hyperreflective echo corresponding to the areas of the retinitis suggestive of a toxo. Here is a child who not responding to the child was the presenting complaint. Anterior segment examination was normal. Fundus examination revealed mid-peripheral and peripheral. We can see the subretinal whitish yellowish lesions. Child also has a PDA with ear deafness. The positive rubella type of confirming the diagnosis of rubella retinitis. We just followed up the child and subsequently we could see the healing retinitis with decreasing the titer of the rubella. Here is a 3-month-old child presented with fever. On evaluation, the child had active retinal vasculitis in both eyes. Diagnosed have a urinary tract infection secondary to E. coli, which was sensitive to amikacin. Following systemic antibiotic administrations, we could see the complete resolution of the retinal vasculitis in both eyes. Here is a 4-month-old infant at respiratory distress syndrome on oxygen supplements. So when we presented, we could see the yellowish lesions in the fundus. Most often we diagnose this fungal infection, second presence of, mostly it's seen in the posterior pole. In this particular infant, it's seen in the extreme periphery. And PCR for the panfungal from the serum is positive. Child also had a systemic and lung infections. Following antifungal treatment, we could see the decreasing in the size of the retinal infiltrates. Here, an 8-week-old infant suspected to have a cytomegalovirus pneumonitis referred for ophthalmic evaluation. So, on examination, we could see the discrete choroiditis lesions in the both eyes. It's ill-defined and found to have active. So, when we investigated, not only the child but also the mother found to have active tuberculosis. So we made the diagnosis of neonatal tuberculosis with persistent pneumonitis with choroidal granuloma. Here the OCT shows the ill-defined area of the hyporeflective lesions with hyperreflective echo in the outer retina. Following treatment with anti-TB drugs, there is complete resolution of the granuloma in both eyes with improvement in the visual acuities. Next we'll move on to the pediatric uveitis. Here is a classical case of granulomatous anterior uveitis secondary to presumed ocular tuberculosis. The child responded to anti-TB drugs along with topical steroids and cycloplegic agents. Here is a 5-year-old boy who had recurrent granulomatous pan uveitis. When he presented to us, he had a band-shaped keratopathy, posterior synechiae, complicated cataract in both eyes. The recurrent inflammation is evidenced by the presence of both COPIs as well as the Busaka's nodules. On investigations, the MANTU was negative and he had increased serum ACE levels, and we did the CD4 and CD8 ratio from the systemically, that is also was elevated. Subsequently, after controlling the inflammations with systemic steroids and systemic methotrexate therapy, the child underwent first initially the band-shaped keratopathy removal, subsequently the cataract surgery. After that, we could see the fundus examination, which shows the presence of hyper-reflective lesions on the OCT corresponding to the areas of the peripapillary excrescence, confirming the possibility of the diagnosis of the Bloss syndrome, that is juvenile systemic granulomatous disease. Along the course, the child also had skin lesions. Here is a 3-year-old child referred for second opinion. The child is asymptomatic. On examination, had a band-shaped keratopathy, posterior synechiae, and complicated cataract. Subsequently, during the course of the disease, the child developed a knee joint swelling and effusion, and ANA was 2+, diagnosed have a juvenile idiopathic arthritis. Inflammation was controlled with topical steroids, systemic steroids, and immunosuppressive therapy with methotrexate. Then the child underwent a band-shaped keratopathy removal followed by a cataract surgery in both eyes. So most of the times, JAA patients are asymptomatic, and routine slit lamp examination will pick up the anterior segment inflammations. When newly diagnosed JAA, the child needs to undergo slit lamp biomicroscopic examination to assess the presence of inflammations. Even if they don't have, we need to follow up this child periodically. Either they can have a particular onset of JAA with arthritis duration of less than 4 years, or with ANA positivity, systemic onset of the Sills disease. So if it's high risk, we examine this child once in 3 months. If it's moderate risk, we examine them for once in 6 months. It's a low risk, one yearly examination is important for the detection of the uveitis. Here is a 10-year-old boy presented with redness and pain in the left eye of 15 days duration. The inflammation was controlled with topical and systemic steroids, and along the course diagnosed have cystic lesions in the anterior segments, diagnosis of cysticercosis, following which the viscoexpression of the cyst was done. So whenever we see a cysticercosis, if it's intraocular, if this thing is live, we do not have to put them on anti-helminthic drugs. We have to control the inflammations with systemic steroids, and we have to remove the cyst in situ. Suppose if it's there in the extraocular muscles or outside the eye, then we can treat them with anti-helminthic and systemic steroids. Diagnosed our cysticercosis. Next, we'll move on to an 8-year-old epidic stromal keratouveitis in the right eye. The child responded well to topical and systemic antiviral therapy with the topical steroids and anti-glaucoma medications. The tematode granuloma has been described by Dr. Ratinam et al. From South India. It's more common in this Tamil Nadu region, where we treat them with topical and systemic steroids, or we can aspirate the granuloma if it's there in the anterior segment of the eye. Fuchs' heterochromic iridocyclitis is most often underdiagnosed and overtreated. Here, the patient can have complicated cataract and anterior vitritis, or they can have microgranulomatous keratic precipitates. Some few viral infections are known to be associated with this. Otherwise, the cataract surgery and the monitoring of intraocular pressure will do to monitor the disease. Intermediate uveitis, they have a quite anterior segment. Anterior vitreous cells will be present, and snowball opacities and snowbanking are the diagnostic features. So whenever we see intermediate uveitis, we need to rule out tuberculosis, sarcoidosis, and syphilitic infections. Coming to the approach, whenever we have, if it's unilateral, we try to give them the periocular steroids. If it's bilateral, then we'll move on to the systemic steroids. If the inflammation is persisting for more than 3 months, we switch over to immunosuppressive therapy. They're not responding to immunosuppressive therapy, after ruling out the possibility of the latent tuberculosis, we treat them with biological agents. Not responding, vitrectomy can be done. The toxoplasmosis is the commonest cause of infectious posterior uveitis, where we can have a congenital toxoplasmosis lesion or acquired retinitis or the reactivation of a scar. They diagnose based on the clinical presentations. Serological evaluations can help us to confirm the diagnosis, or molecular diagnostics like a PCR for the B1 gene can confirm the diagnosis. Here is a 10-year-old boy diagnosed with toxoplasmic retinochoroiditis with positive toxoplasma titer, where we can see the yellowish lesions in the right eye. On investigations, you could see the presence of the epiretinal membrane. There is a break in the Bruch's membrane with hyperreflective echoes in the outer retina with fluid in the outer retina, suggestive of the possibility of the CNVM. FFA also confirms the same. Following anti-VGF, you could see the resolving CNVM in this right eye. Tuberculous choroiditis can have multiple choroidal granulomas, can be associated with serous detachment, and they respond well to systemic ATT and systemic steroids. CMV retinitis is seen in immunodeficient individuals. They respond to systemic ganciclovir along with ART. If the child is cooperative, then we can give the intravitreal injections ganciclovir as well. Here is a 13-year-old male child, immunocompromised, presented with headache since 3 months. His headache was disproportionate to the amount of the inflammation what we have seen in the eye. He is not started on ART. CD4 count was 378. Fundus picture shows significant vitreous ace with vitreous exudates inferiorly. On investigations, the CT scan shows hydrocephalus. LP confirmed the diagnosis of TBM. The child was started with ATT, systemic steroids, ART, and underwent VP shunt. You could see the resolving inflammations. Many times the inflammations cannot have restricted only to the eye, and they can have systemic manifestations. Here is an 8-year-old female child presented with blurring of visions, referred as CSR, following increasing stress in the school. OCT shows the presence of posterior vitreous cells and serous detachment in both eyes. FFA shows multiple pinpoint hyperfluorescence with pulling of the dye. ICG also shows multiple hyperreflective dots suggestive of an active inflammation. Following treatment with systemic IVMP followed by oral steroids, there is decreasing serous detachment. 2 months after that, when we did, eye was absolutely quiet, vision was normal, FFA is also normal, but ICG shows presence of hyperreflective choroidal granuloma suggestive of an active inflammation, where we started the child on systemic immunosuppressive therapy. Here is a 13-year-old boy, open globe injury in the right eye. Left eye has mutton fire keratic precipitates, has vitritis, papillitis with extensive retinal detachment, exudative retinal detachment, suggestive of a sympathetic ophthalmia. FFA and ICG confirming the same. Following treatment with systemic steroids and immunosuppressive therapy, we could see the completely resolved inflammations with sunset glow fundus with the visual acuity of 6-9 in the left eye. Here, 13-year-old female child had sudden decrease in vision in the right eye, fever since 4 days. Joint pain, mouth ulcers, and rashes are present in the palms and the soles on systemic antibiotics. No perception of light in the right eye, and RAPD was noted, had combined CRBO in the left eye. On evaluation, the child had leukopenia, microcystic hypochromic anemia with anti-DS DNA strongly positive. Diagnosis of SLE was made, and child was put on systemic steroids and systemic immunosuppressive therapy. Many times in pediatric age group, the uveitis can mimic masquerades. We need to rule out other conditions. Here is a child who had an iris nodules secondary to acute lymphoblastic leukemia. It's a pseudohypopion secondary to retinoblastoma. Yet again, it's a child in the case of retinoblastoma. So we need to rule out masquerades in a pediatric age group. So I'd like to conclude with this case. Here is a child, 43 weeks, came for ROP screening. During the time, we noticed some amount of exudations and vasculitis in the mid-periphery in both eyes. On evaluation, the child was asymptomatic, but we asked the neonatologist to look for a systemic focus of infections. 4 days later, the child developed a fever, and on urine microscopy, shows Candida albicans by positive germ tube test, and abdominal ultrasound shows perinephric abscess. Following treatment with systemic amphotericin B, there is complete resolution of the retinal vasculitis as well as the perinephric abscess, and we could save the child. To conclude, in pediatric uveitis, we need to rule out infections as well as masquerades, and then we need to start the child on corticosteroids. It can be in the form of intravenous, oral, or periocular steroids. Whenever we need to continue the steroids for more than 3 months, it's preferable to switch over to immunosuppressive therapy. A detailed history and thorough clinical examination still remain the most important diagnostic tool. Working on uveitis is like being a detective, putting the unlikely clues together to arrive at the correct diagnosis. Tailor make the investigations according to the clinical picture, and aggressive and appropriate treatment can help to preserve the vision. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Padmavali, for an excellent talk.